coming for you!
Sex, sex.
Did you say that? You are a monk, remember? I sometimes say to him, the cameras are on us.
Honestly, the energy between them is 8-year-old boy.
You are mischievous.
What is the purpose of your visit, sir?
Just enjoy our friendship and talk about joy.
I don't think you could find two people on the planet who are more different than the Dalai Lama and Desmond Tutu. One grew up in absolute poverty, the other grew up in a 1,000-room palace.
Unfortunately, that person is Christian.
Unfortunately, he's a Buddhist.
There's a lot of shared background. Both of them have deep history of struggle against authoritarian systems.
The Tibetan people are being exterminated. Their culture and religion are being stamped out.
Age 24, I lost my own country.
Amid tear gas and police dogs, Desmond Tutu led a people against apartheid.
When people decide to be free, absolutely nothing is going to stop them from becoming free.
You can overcome the most horrendous circumstances and emerge on the other side not broken. When you say you are pursuing happiness, you are not going to find it.
Happiness isn't just something that feels good. Happier people, they're physically healthier, they have stronger immune systems, they even live longer.
Ultimate source of happy life, inside, not outside.
We really become something quite special.
Yes.
I think at time of my death, I will remember you.
Thank you.
Welcome. Every time I hear those dear friends cracking each other up, I just have to laugh with them. Thank you for joining us. We are delighted that you're here. There's more than 3,600 of you tuning in from 70 countries, spanning more than 1,000 academic institutions. Wow. Wherever you are, we're glad you're here. I'm Peggy Callahan, and we get to learn about joy today from some of my favorite people on the planet. We're all part of the team that created the documentary film with the Dalai Lama and Archbishop Desmond Tutu called Mission Joy, Finding Happiness in Troubled Times. We'll share some of the behind the scenes details and what we learned from the self-described mischievous brothers. I was lucky enough to co-direct and produce the film. Now, this gathering is made possible because Film Platform chose our film to be among their best of the best documentary film collection for schools. How lucky are we? And ProQuest makes it possible for films like Mission Joy to be easily used in classrooms and for research. If you haven't seen Mission Joy yet, well, get with the program, and you can watch it through your university library on ProQuest. The Dalai Lama and Archbishop Tutu only asked one thing of us, and that is to get their message of joy, their mission, to as many people as possible. Thank you for being a part of the mission. Goodness knows we could all use a little more joy. And it turns out, joy starts with each of us because joy is an inside job. Now, to be clear, today is all about you and your questions. So thank you for your compelling questions you've already submitted, and we will be sharing those. We'd also love to hear from more of you now. So just write your questions in the Q&A box below. Please include your first name, the name of your school or organization, and where you're from. And just so you're aware, the event will be recorded. And now for our panelists. I have to take a deep breath because they're so accomplished, it takes a bit to get through it. Dr. Alyssa Epple studies stress resilience and mindfulness interventions in coping with adversity. Alyssa is one of the leaders of the Big Joy Citizen Science Project for our film's impact campaign. She's also a member of the National Academy of Medicine, president of the Academy of Behavioral Medicine Research, and co-chair of the Mind and Life Institute Steering Committee. Clearly, I hang out with a lot of slackers. Alyssa, is there a personal story behind the story? What drives you to seek and learn and share all you know about coping with adversity?
Thank you for that very big question, Peggy. I'm just so delighted to be here with you, Doug and Jimpa, and be sharing this film with our audience and getting to talk about it. So I'm a stress scientist. I've been studying how suffering and stress get under the skin to impact our health and our well-being. And I've been doing that for about 25 years. And, you know, I call it studying the dark side and adversity and the amazing lessons that we have learned is that we actually can experience joy sometimes the most clearly and intensely when we are actually living with adversity or struggling through adversity, or as we say, we've grown once the adversity has passed. So I live with adversity personally. I have a son born with a chronic condition that causes a lot of suffering. And so it's one of those situations where you can't change it. It's not going to end. You can only change how you live with it and within it. And so it's like any disability, chronic condition, or any event that happens to you that you don't want or don't ask for. And so the question really is, where do we focus our attention and how do we live when we have sadness, when we have things we don't want? And that has really brought me personally to lessons of the Dalai Lama and Buddhism, that joy is within. It's not in the situations that we're given, it's within, and that we can focus our attention on what we do have, on appreciating the joy of living, the joy of love. And so that is how I try to live within my own situations that, you know, come and go. And you know, I'll just call it a chronically stressful situation. So that's been a lesson to me personally. I have shifted my research over the last 10 years to studying joy and how we can use well-being to amplify it, because naturally our attention goes to suffering. It's like, it's been called like Velcro, whereas we don't pay as much attention to the positive. That's, you know, more of like a Teflon pan experience. And so we can actually change that within a moment and focus on the joy that's present in our life, in our world, in front of us. And that's what I've been studying. So we'll talk more about how our body, our cells respond to happiness, joy, and purpose in dramatic ways that we're only now discovering.
Thank you, Alyssa. I think we're done here. See ya.
Yeah, like drop the mic. That was fantastic. That was awesome. I think you covered it all.
See, yeah, you saved us a lot of time. Yeah. now I want you to meet Tupten Jimpa Lingri. Also, he also has a doctorate, and I think it's from Cambridge. I first met Jimpa in India as we began recording the dialogues between Archbishop Tutu and His Holiness. Jimpa is a former Tibetan monk, and since 1985, he's been the principal English translator to His Holiness the Dalai Lama. Here we go again. He is also a co-founder and president of the Compassion Institute, the chair of Mind and Life Institute, founder of the Institute of Tibetan Classics, and an adjunct professor at the School of Religious Studies at McGill University. Clearly, another underachiever in our midst. Jimpa, you have spent decades being with His Holiness in every conceivable gathering. What was it like being in the room when these wise global icons got together for 5 days? Because we already know that Arch's daughter thinks they act like eight-year-olds when they're together.
Yeah, I agree with her. Actually, one of the amazing things about their friendship is that there is clearly a powerful chemistry between these two great spiritual teachers of our time. As the film says, that you know, these two spiritual leaders come from completely different backgrounds. You know, they're the two individuals who can be as different as they can be in terms of their background. But when they are together, there is a kind of a level of affection for each other, personal friendship. I would even call it intimacy. And there's a genuine sense of being at ease with each other. And, you know, and Archbishop's daughter is right. There is that childlike energy. And for me, having had the privilege to be with His Holiness for so, you know, such a long time and having been able to see him interact with so many people, there's no one like Archbishop Desmond Tutu to see that His Holiness, even His Holiness, who's normally associated with someone who's a happy guy, you know, I mean, a happy man, and it comes through in his laughter, sense of humor, spontaneity. But with Archbishop, I noticed that His Holiness is able to somehow increase a notch up his level of joy and fun. And it's, for me personally, it's deeply inspiring because here are two great spiritual teachers of our time who each of them have had a hard life with respect to, you know, campaigning for the rights of their own people in, you know, against, rising against authoritarian systems and all of this. And they're constantly exposed to hearing about sufferings of their people. Yet these two great spiritual teachers also remind us life is also about joy. You know, life, of course, suffering is there, but life is also about a joy. And that joy is very spontaneous and natural. And I think that is a powerful lesson, especially for those of us who really care about seeing a kinder world, more compassionate world, more equitable world. Sometimes because of our, you know, our aspirations, sometimes we get too serious. You know, we forget that there is also a joy to be experienced. And I would in fact argue that if we can find that spark of joy, even in our own work, the work may be very serious. It may involve helping so many people who are suffering. Yet at the same time, I would argue that being able to bring that spark of joy will help sustain motivation to be able to dig in there. So I think that's what I really get from His Holiness and Archbishop Desmond Tutu. You know, when I see them, all of this just spontaneously come into my mind.
I think that's a great description of it. Thank you. And now for slacker number three. Doug Abrams is a best-selling author, editor, literary agent, and film producer. He is founder and president of Idea Architects, a creative book and media agency, helping visionaries create a wiser, healthier, and more just world. He has written with books with Desmond Tutu for more than 20 years. And he co-authored the global bestseller, Book of Joy, with Desmond Tutu and the Dalai Lama. Now, we shot the dialogues that became the book, which then inspired the film Mission Joy. Doug and Jempa worked on the questions for the Holy Men. Doug did the interviews in the film, and both of them are executive producers of the film. Now, Doug, I know it meant a lot to all of us, but perhaps especially you, to help the Dalai Lama and Archbishop Tutu get their message out that we do have agency over joy in our lives, that we don't have to wait for joy to tap us on the shoulders. We can create joy ourselves, but you took on a big job. So I know a little bit about what happened the night before we started shooting. Can you share with us what happened?
Sure. Well, let me first off just say that I learned from Archbishop Tutu to start with gratitude. And I just want to thank you for this incredible panel and my co-panelists, Alyssa and Jempa, and all who are tuning in here for this really special opportunity to be together and explore joy at a time of enormous hardship and pain that so many people are feeling around the world with the pandemic, with the climate, with so many things. And I know we were teasing each other about CVs and everything, but the point is, it's really not about our achievements or our academics or our credits. We're here together as human beings, all trying to understand the same question about how do we have a good day and a good life and find joy in the face of suffering. And that was really the question we were after, was how do we have joy in the face of life's inevitable adversity? And this is a deeply personal question for me, because I grew up with a mom who suffered from depression and anxiety, experienced some of that depression as a child and teenager. And I know that so much suffering happens in our own heads as well as in the world around us. And so that question was really a question that I was desperate to answer for myself and also to be able to share with others. And the night before we were to, and I think these two men do an incredible job of showing you that you can be Nobel Peace Laureates, you can be great spiritual leaders, and you have this incredible shining humanity that they have, that shows us that we are all connected in the fundamental challenges that we all face. But nonetheless, I was, the night before we were to begin, I was daunted by the fact of like, who the hell am I to interview these two great spiritual masters? And I was woken at 3 o'clock in the morning as if I had been shaken. And the Dalai Lama gets up every night at 3 o'clock in the morning to meditate, as he told us. But I only get up at 3 o'clock in the morning when my demons get me up. And the demon that got me up this time was the demon of self-doubt. And I was like, you know, like, when is Anderson Cooper or Oprah Winfrey going to come in and do these interviews so I can like sit down? But unfortunately, Oprah and Anderson did not come. And I was the one who needed to ask the questions. And one of the things that I think that Arch has told me, and the voice I heard as well, besides the voice of doubt that night, was his voice saying, you know, sometimes you're the one that's in the room and needs to just be there to let happen what wants to happen. After I was able to surrender that, and, you know, it's this fascinating thing about how we have more joy and more hope. Arch said this wonderful thing during the dialogue of, you will be surprised by the joy when you go beyond your own self-regard. So it's this fascinating thing of like, when we're preoccupied and ruminating with ourselves and our own strengths or weaknesses, in this case, I was worried about my own limitations. You know, we're often in a great deal of anxiety and suffering, but when we go beyond that self-regard and are able to turn to the world and just be the channel for what is wanting to happen, it is so much more blissful. And that week was this incredible week of bliss.
Wow. Thank you, Doug. Now, I just want to share a little behind the scenes of what was happening. While these guys were coming up with deep and profound questions, really that help us leave a better life, I was obsessed with creating a set in the Dalai Lama's compound, because we had teams from three different countries working. We hadn't worked together before. And by the way, we had no room to make a mistake. So I would tell people, you're going to be jet lagged. It's going to be tough. Oh, and by the way, you can't make a mistake. We even had a monk running a camera, which I think might be the highlight of my career. That just makes me happy every time I think about it. We had equipment that was trucked in from 12 hours away from Delhi. We were scheduled in between medical treatments for Arch. I personally was really concerned about His Holiness's eyes, because they're quite sensitive to light. That's why you see him wear visors a lot, or you see him wear dark glasses. And because we knew this would be such an intense and personal experience, we didn't want to have dark glasses or visors. We wanted just to be able to see His Holiness really clearly. So we had to use as little light as possible and still get a picture, and which was a trick. So I have to tell you, when he walked in, when the moment was finally happening, I could not look. I was like, oh, please, 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 please. And I started peeking, please let this work. And when they finally sat down, and when we finally were able to shoot, and there wasn't a single really technical glitch ever the entire 5 days, when you have five cameras and all of this going on, well, if I didn't believe in what was holy and what was meant to be before, I sure do now. It was amazing. And now we get to move on to our first video question today, which is from Emily. And Emily really reflects what so many of us are feeling and so many of you are asking. And that is, how do we hang on in a world devastated by COVID, oppression, climate change, violence? And how do we re-enter a different world from the one we left as we finally get back to school or to work?
Hi, my name is Emily Moxley, and I am the head of access services at Barber Library at Central Oregon Community College. And my question is, over the past 18 months plus, I have found it difficult to hold on to hope. Is there any advice on how to nurture hope? Thank you.
I want to jump for a second next to our next topic, which is about despair and hopelessness. According to the UN, 350 million people in our world suffer from depression. They've no longer have hope. What do you say to people who come to this work where that sadness has become despair and hopelessness?
Sometimes the people completely lost their hope like that. The real, I think, inner spirit or warm-heartedness really makes differences.
Yes, but I think he is wanting to say, how do we help people who really want to be joyful, but who are holding on by the skin of their teeth? For me, when I have some anguish in my life, what keeps me going is that I am a prisoner of hope, but it's not something that just comes ready-made from heaven. We are human beings, fallible human beings. And His Holiness points out that, we see Him so serene and calm, but there was a time when He too and His Holiness's serenity didn't come ready-made. It was through the practice of prayer, meditation, that the gentleness, the compassion grew. It's like muscles that have to be exercised in order for them to get their right tone and to be strengthened.
I've come to realize from these men that joy is this clean energy that actually fuels so much of everything else in our life. Alyssa, you know we see this film as an on-ramp to have much-needed mental health conversations. Help us out here. Arch talks about exercising joy muscles. But what if you're depressed and suffering from anxiety, as record numbers of young people are? Yeah. What if you just can't get to joy? What then?
Such a good question, Peg. Thank you. I just have to say this, what I just heard from Desmond Tutu. I'm a prisoner of hope. I just am going to hold on to that, because I think hope is also an iterative process, a muscle we build that we have to iteratively reconnect to our deep belief in the goodness of life and the goodness of the human spirit. And it's hard with what we see today. We have moral distress, we have moral injury, we have anxiety, and we have widespread depression. And so this idea of having role models for hope is really important, because we're social mammals and hope is contagious. So I'm going to remember that quote. And I think that I have in my own life people that give me hope, and I try to also transmit it to others. So it's a wonderful regenerative fuel like joy. So what if you can't get to joy? So I guess number one is just know that you are not alone, that so many people, especially young adults, are suffering right now. And it's natural because of what we've gone through socially. Our world is in distress. And so there's a lot to remember. Number one is to not criticize yourself about this, but to allow it, make room for it, express it, and most importantly, express it to someone you trust, some wise person in your life that you can share that you're feeling depressed. And seeking help is a strength. It is resilience. So showing that you're feeling sad or weak is a strength. That's so important to remember, because we all need extra support right now, and especially if we're prone to depression. So finding a counselor or other ways of seeking support. Secondly, knowing and understanding the nature of joy, that actually you might not feel it in the moment, but that it is all around you and you can experience it in the next moment. And we're going to get to, by the end, some exercises that create joy instantly. And I'm going to just ask you to do one thing right now that helps you feel some joy. And that is, I'm going to ask for two things. One is, think of something that you do have in your life that you can feel appreciation for. One thing. And let yourself feel that gratitude. Gratitude is a phenomenal emotion that actually changes our whole worldview, from kind of glass half full to glass half empty. And then secondly, I want you to think of some person that you're grateful for. And it could be something someone's done for you. And, you know, I work at a huge institution, and people are feeling a lot of depression and burnout. And we know that expressing gratitude to someone you see each day, someone you work with, actually immediately changes their mood and can also change how you feel. And so I'd like you to text someone or email or say to someone today something that you're grateful for specifically that they did and how it affected you. And so that specificity is powerful. So it's not just thank you, but thank you, you made this easier for me, or you made me see things this way.
Wow, that's wonderful. Thank you. Now, in the film, we get to witness that these men survived so many things that we see as heartbreaking and life-shattering. And we also see that they just keep laughing, and they have joy through all of this. Now, I truly believe that if the Dalai Lama actually believed in hell, clearly these men have been to hell and back several times, and they maybe even had a condo there for a while. And I suspect that you all have had some of the same experiences, and you may have a condo in that warm place too. So I'm wondering, can you share some of your own strategies for living with joy? Can you give us just a few quick hits? Like, when I feel bad, I do this and it seems to work. Could you do that?
Sure. Are you directing that to any particular one of us, or you want to?
I wanted to hear from all three of you, because I'm running out of ideas someday. So I'm getting ready to steal yours.
Doug, well, you're up.
Okay, well, I'll start with saying, yeah, just in terms of the condo in hell, over the last 18 months, or 2 years, actually, my dad died, my son had a serious traumatic brain injury, and two dear friends died, one from suicide and one from a drug overdose. So, I think we all know what it's like to spend some time in anguish. And I think what Alyssa said was really important, that we have four fundamental human emotions. We have fear, anger, sadness, and joy. And the fear, anger, and sadness that we experience, we're not to be ashamed of those. And we're not to think that joy is somehow better than those other feelings. Like, being human, being alive, is experiencing all those feelings and learning from all of those emotional experiences. And but fear, anger, and sadness ultimately exist to get us back to joy. They're to remind us that something is off and that we can get back to our birthright, which is joy. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things that Alyssa mentioned was gratitude. And there are 8 pillars of joy that the Dalai Lama and Desmond Tutu gave us that are in the Book of Joy, and many of which we talk about in the film. And those pillars of joy are perspective, humor, acceptance, and what am I forgetting? Gratitude, generosity, compassion. And, but the first pillar of joy, which is perspective, is really very powerful, because when we fixate on the what is painful and heartbreaking, either in our own life or in our world, then that's all we see. And that's where often the fear, the anger, the sadness, the outrage comes from. But as they told us, if you remember all that is in context, if you widen that lens and you see what else is there, that you see what else exists in our world, like Archbishop Tutu said, you know, in history, it's two steps forward, one step back. Yes, there may be this anguishing terrorist attack that happens. There may be this rise of an autocratic, despotic leader. We may have these various anguishes that happen in our world. But ultimately, if we remember that arc of history and remember that just, you know, 100 years ago, we, you know, how different life was and how the rights of women or the existence of slavery, I mean, those things were taken for granted in ways that today we have a wholly different consciousness. And so when we widen that lens, either on our world and recognize all the good that is happening, they talked about how, you know, news is the news because it's the aberration, right? That murder is not most of what's happening in the world. That terrorist attack is not what's happening mostly in the world. Mostly what's happening in the world is parents are loving children, caregivers are loving sick people. There's an extraordinary amount of goodness that is happening, but we don't focus on it. Because we're focusing on the things that that we're most fearful about or worried about. But if we open that lens, and in our own life, are also able to think, yes, the heartache, the heartbreak is real, but when we're able to put it in its proper place, then we're able to both experience the sadness, the anger, the fear that comes with that heartbreak, but we're also able to put it in its proper place. And this is what I think they are able to do so magnificently. I think they are not ignoring what is broken and in our world and even broken in their own lives, but they're able to put it in its context and recognize and be grateful for all that is there that is beautiful and joyful. And I think that is a beautiful example for us.
Oh, thank you, Doug. And we're also gonna follow up on that later in the program, because they address that directly. Jempa, what are the, give us some quick hits about when you're really feeling down and it's difficult. What do you try to do? What do you do?
I think both Alyssa and Doug really shared powerfully the ways in which we could actually, I would call it, you know, turning our own mind into an ally. Because often, you know, the problems are exacerbated because our mind creates a loop, and then we end up sort of going down that spiral. So this is one area where, you know, adopting a certain stance, like perspective, seeing the situation in, you know, more proportionately rather than, you know, just looking close up. I suppose in my own case, you know, I had the privilege to be brought up in a traditional Tibetan culture, and also having grown up as a refugee child, a Tibetan refugee in India, I think experience of suffering and need and displacement, all of this was part of my experience of growing up. So I think probably there is some truth in the saying that, you know, either kills you, suffering either kills you or you get stronger. So, and I don't mean to suggest that in order to be resilient, you need to suffer. But there is something to be said for actually having the experience of suffering and hardships. But in any case, regardless of the nature of specificity of suffering, I don't think human beings can ever, any human beings can avoid pain and suffering, you know. Some may, you know, the nature of the suffering will be different. People who are more materially affluent will not suffer poverty like the refugee kids, like, you know, my parents. When they first came to India, I had to work on road construction camps in a totally foreign country, not being able to speak the local language. So people who are materially affluent will not have that kind of suffering, but then there will be other kind of suffering because we are social creatures. We care about what other people think. There's going to be a dysfunction in relationship because no human being, no two human beings are going to ever think exactly alike. How do we deal with it, you know? So, and worries is an important part of, and then both Elissa and Doug pointed out that human brain is a strange brain which tends to get fixated on the problem side, you know, what, you know, Elissa beautifully described it as a Velcro, we get stuck. So, so the suffering is always going to be there. And, you know, there's, I often think of, and this is a favorite quote from His Holiness as well, there's an 8th century Indian Buddhist spiritual author, a teacher, Shantideva. You know, he has this metaphor. He says that in order to protect yourself from pain, you know, being your, you know, heels being pricked by a thorn, if you try to cover the entire face of the earth with leather, this is an impossible task. You're never going to succeed. Whereas if you cover your tiny soles by good leather, that's going to do the trick. So similarly, you know, things are going to happen to us in our life. We don't really have total control, even though we may like to think, and especially modern contemporary people, we are control freaks, you know, especially in the West, you know, a lot of people are control freaks. But the fact is, what happens to us, to a large extent, we don't really have a say. But where we do have a say is how do we respond to what is happening to us? And this is the area where, you know, paying attention to the importance of joy, paying attention to particularly importance of relationships. So the question of hope was raised. I think, you know, sometimes in the West, there is a tendency to believe too much in the autonomy and wanting to do everything by ourselves. So we have this superhuman image of us. And if we need someone, it's seen as a weakness. So of course, you would want to avoid over-dependency, but at the same time, you don't want to create a life where you shut out everybody else in your, from your life. So, and as social creatures, the best way of dealing with depression, best way of dealing with stress and suffering is to seek help, to reach out, to feel connected. And we know, for example, like loneliness is a major issue in the West particularly. And then the strongest antidote against loneliness is relationship. We open space for others to be in our life. We reach out, we share our, you know, pain with others. So I think there are ways in which we humans can really turn our own mind into an ally. And at the same time, bring a dose of humility that things are going to happen in our life. We are not going to have a total control over our life, you know, what happens to us. And just having that degree of humility and acceptance, you know, and then creates a space where you are more resilient, you're more able to, you know, accept rather than deny and reject, because often large part of the pain comes from resistance, you know, and then in order to, you know, because we don't like aversive experience, and in order to protect us from aversive experience, we put layers and layers of resistance, and in the end, the resistance themselves create more headache.
So I thank think you, Jampa. Yeah. Thank you, thank you. You guys, I can't believe we actually only have 24 minutes left because I'm enjoying this so much. And we're going to now start making sure we reach a lot of these people who are asking questions and watch some more video. So I'm going to do a better job of asking us to give shorter answers. I can't help it. I'm so obsessed with you guys that I want to hear everything you say. Alyssa, can you give us?
I'm going to try. Okay. This is a hard one. What is the condo in hell that I've been living on? The same one we all have been living on. So we all have our personal drama, you know, our daily drama, I call it. And, you know, I shared mine earlier, which is caring about someone who's suffering. And that's just so common. What maybe it's someone with addiction, et cetera. And, you know, part of the lesson is realizing what you can control. Like Jampa said, you can be there. with love, and you have no control over another person. You can just, you know, offer and be present and give a loving presence. But the condo in hell that we all live on together is the existential stress that we are seeing the harm of the earth, and we know it will get worse. And so we always say, when we're under distress, something that can help is, this too shall pass. And we don't have that right now. We have a tough lifetime together. And so it's so important that we actually use that regenerative energy of joy to turn our hope into active hope, as Joanna Macy says, into action, into doing the work. And the work is whatever you decide it is in your realm. So I think it's so easy to feel helpless, to feel that we're one person, and that autonomy, that false autonomy, we can change and save the world. We can do our little bit, but together it adds up. So I feel that what I use a lot right now to comfort myself is remembering the contagion of those small things we can do for the earth or for someone else that will be contagious.
Wow.
Good contagion.
Thank you. So Maggie from West Suburban Medical Center, she actually gets all of this about joy. And she really understands the power of joy, but she could use some help speaking about it. She says, when joy is considered by some to be insignificant or small, what can I say as to the power and contagion of joy? I suspect you all know something about this, but Jempla, can you briefly try to help her out a little bit on this?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think often the most powerful way of communicating the power of joy is to actually embody it, show it. Because joy is very contagious. I mean, joy is a bit like laughter. When someone laughs, other people generally tend to laugh because we are such social creatures. Nice. So as much as possible, if you can show joy, that's probably, I would say, one of the most effective way of communicating its value. Yeah.
Wow, that's good.
And Peggy, can I just add that I think that it's really important to recognize that joy is actually can be a revolutionary act in the face of oppression and in the face of despair. And that, I mean, I think that's one of the things that the Dalai Lama and Desmond Tutu are able to do in the face of that, in those incredible situations of suffering and oppression, is to remember that joy is an expression of our humanity. And so it is incredibly powerful and important. And actually, one of the things that Arch said to me was, if you want people to join your movement or join the positive actions that you're doing in the world, you have to look like you're having a good time. Nobody's going to, you know, join the funeral. So you're going to have to, you know, make it a parade and recognize that your joy, as, you know, Alyssa said, is contagious to others.
Wow. I like that. Many people wrote in about negativity in the world, about the negative impact of social media that should be able to unite us, but so often separates us. Amy Lynn, a teacher in Florida, asked, how can a teacher help young people feel accepted and overcome the negativity of social media? Now, Jempla and Alyssa, I know you deal with a lot of young people. Could you weigh in on Amy Lynn's question?
After you, Jempla.
No, Alyssa, you go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. This contagion of emotion is real. Two examples from science. The social network literature shows that depression travels in social networks. People 3 degrees removed from you that are connected to you feel more depression if you do. It's an amazing, I know it's mind-blowing, but the same thing occurs for happiness and joy. It is socially networked in these studies, in these ways, by, you know, at least 3 degrees of separation. So social media is a contagious medium. We now know that disgust and anger and moral outrage, they travel like wildfire. That's why we have such polarity in our opinions. We're such a divisive society. But joy does as well. And so Facebook studies have shown that if you're getting positive words on your feed, you feel better. So you can use that for good. And then right to your question, social media can make us feel terrible. And we know how much it impacts youth and young adults because people project a false artificial world of extremes. And so not just the anger, but the, you know, the positive romanticized life that no one really has. So I think the limiting use and trying to have more in-person connections than media connections is so important.
And one of the things I just would add, I think Alyssa knows this research so well, but one of the really important things that they found is that active engagement with social media versus passive engagement is really important. So if you're just scrolling through your feed passively, it makes most people unhappy. If you're actually engaging with your friends through social media and really what Alyssa said, adding hearts, going through and really trying to reach out for help or communicate with people in a meaningful way through social media, then it can actually increase your affect and increase your emotional life.
Yes, absolutely. It's that passive viewing that's related to depression. So personal messaging and using the phone are much healthier.
Thank you. Jeppa, what do you have to say?
Well, I mean, I'm a father of two young girls in early 20s now. I mean, one of the things that I try to share with them, and I'm not a big social media person. I do have a Facebook account. I only use it when I have to broadcast something and then I switch off. So right from the beginning, I noticed the sort of the potential for dark side of Facebook and other social media platforms. So I didn't want to go there. But one thing that I do try to tell my two daughters is what is really important is for them to have a good confidence, sense of confidence in who they are, their values, and which is reinforced through a network of close friends they can really trust. And then all the other exchanges, criticisms, rumors, da-da-da-da that will come up in the social media post is not going to impact you badly because you have a core gut sense of who you are, which is reinforced by your close friends who know you well. Because people are going to comment, okay, for whatever post you do. And millions of these people or whatever, 90% of these people who are going to comment wouldn't know you who you are. Their judgment would be based on some superficial images or statements that you make. So I tell them that if you're going to post something and if you're going to be in the social media space, make sure that you have a core group of good friends that you can truly trust who's going to reinforce your sense of who you are so that when you are exposed to all the negativity and criticism and rumors and all of this, you are more resilient. I think this is probably an important lesson for many other young people to make sure that you don't get swayed and depressed by someone's flippant comment that is posted,
That's great. Thank you guys. I'm going to skip ahead because we only have 15 minutes left and I want everyone to be able to hear some from the holy men. And so, I want to go back to the perspective thing because perspective and being able to look at things differently and being able to see the silver lining is such a big deal. And the Dalai Lama in this next clip is really, really adamant about this. Can we roll that clip?
Yes, I agree. Basic human nature is good. Goodness. People who seeing newspaper too much believe that, only that, the one only event on this planet, then feel more hopelessness and feel our humanity is bad and our future not much hope. Yes, there are very sad things, very negative things, but at the same time, there are much more positive things. Then, okay, feel.
Yes, it's how we are made. We're wired to be compassionate. We're wired to be caring for the other. If you live out Ubuntu, Ubuntu says we can be human only together.
it's no surprise that when the essence of their wisdom is distilled, the key to joy is to get in touch with your own natural compassion and live from there. Find a way to live from there.
That makes perfect sense to me. I don't think anyone's going to protest that. Are we on the same page there? Great. We have a question, and we have a lot of librarians and faculty members here in the audience today, and they really want to know, how can they be of service? How can they be stewards of joy on their campuses? Any ideas? Anyone who wants to speak up, just jump right in.
I don't know if people are sharing a chat, but I would just love to see the, you know, the flow of consciousness of what's coming to people's minds and sharing what they have, little things they have done. It comes down to the day and the moment and the smile and the letting yourself laugh. You know, the joy research. What's amazing is that we don't need 6-month interventions to create joy. We can create it in the moment, and it's often between two people. And so a small connection with a stranger, smiling, complimenting, this is changing and elevating people's moods and mindsets in the moment. And so it's not just close relationships, it's actually how we deal with people we don't know as well. So I think there's tremendous opportunity on a campus to warm up the environment. I was just so embarrassed and shocked recently when, you know, someone was brave enough to complain about our academic environment and how people rush around and don't smile and don't have eye contact. And there's, you know, time pressure and perfectionism and all these qualities that take us away from that personal connection in the moment.
That was really beautifully said, Alyssa. I'm thinking about the experience I had at the at UC Davis campus, where they actually chose to read the Book of Joy as a whole campus to focus on joy. And they actually came up with dozens and dozens of different activities and ways to foster joy on their campus. So they might have some really great resources. I think, as Alyssa says, so much of it does come down to the micro level, but I also think it happens at the macro level. It's like, what's the culture that you're fostering? Are you fostering a culture of, you know, kind of cutthroat individualism and isolation and competition and CV comparisons? Or are you helping bring people together to realize our shared humanity and to appreciate the fact that we are all fragile human beings going through this same thing called human life, and to be able to share at that very deep level? And I think colleges are much better now at allowing, encouraging that and fostering that. I also think that, you know, like there's a term now called toxic positivity that people use, where, you know, which I think is important to say that, you know, we don't want to say, you know, we don't want joy in any kind of, inflated way that doesn't acknowledge the fear, anger, and sadness that is real. And at the same time, we also want to recognize that joy is a choice, that we have some volition about it, and we can turn to choice by choosing our perspective there.
Thank you, Doug. Jeff, do you want to
weigh? Well, I don't really have much to add. I mean, I strongly, endorse what my two colleagues have said, and especially emphasize the importance of making human connection, even if it is for half a minute. Right. I think, you know, we know from our own personal experience, when we are able to connect with someone, it really creates a sense of expansiveness.
Right.
We're able to step out of our own narrow shell of, you know, self. And that's when the magic of human connection, you know, brings joy. I think human connection is, I would particularly emphasize this in the more Western individualistic society, where we tend to prioritize individual autonomy as the highest kind of individual and cultural value. And sometimes at the, it is important, but not at the cost of, you know, preventing us from making human connections. And that's
really thank you, Jim. I think we do keep coming back to the holy grail of joy, which is connection and the importance of deep friendships in our lives. I suspect that the importance kind of kindness to build connection feels right to all of us as a lived experience. I suspect we've been around the block a few times about that. And I think we can go back to look at some of the science of joy because there's plenty of research on that subject.
The idea of the dialogues was to explore the nature of joy in the face of adversity. But they also wanted us to bring in the science. They said this shouldn't be a Buddhist dialogue or a Christian dialogue. This should be about the nature of being human. And so they asked me to find out whether what they were saying was confirmed or contradicted by science. Dr. Sonia Libermirsky at the University of California, Riverside, has done some extraordinary studies on the science of happiness.
My lab and I started doing what we call happiness interventions. So they're basically like clinical trials, but instead of testing a new treatment, say for COVID, we're testing a happiness strategy. In one typical study, we found that people who did acts of kindness for others became happier and actually stayed happier for about 2 to 4 weeks after the study was over. And then people who did acts of kindness for themselves felt good while they were doing it, but that didn't change their happiness. So what really was important about kindness was that you're connecting with another person. And it might actually have effects on the body. So we collected blood, and we found that those who did acts of kindness for others showed changes in their RNA gene expression in the blood that were associated with a healthier immune profile. So it turns out that happiness isn't just something that feels good. It's not just about pleasure, but it's more than that. Happier people have more friends. They're also more productive at work. They're more creative. They're physically healthier. They have stronger immune systems. They even live longer.
Okay, Alyssa, we got it. We absolutely know that joy and happiness fuels all kinds of good things, but you're an expert on this. Can you just tell us some of the things we can do, some of the life hacks that we can do to make ourselves feel better?
Yes, and I'm just so excited, Peg, that you have your team has decided to bring some of this science to all of these countries. Anyone listening, and hopefully we'll reach millions of people with these really short practices that we know work through science. And so I'll just list some of them. We've been talking about them. And the beauty is that you can try all of them. You can actually sign up for this kind of citizen science experiment, try them, get feedback on how did this make you feel? And was another exercise a better fit? Because we're all so different. It's not one size fits all. It's really finding what's meaningful to us and what feels right. So I think funnest exercises is empathic laughter. And I just want to hear, you know, the two holy men laughing together because it makes you laugh. And Doug, you just laughed. And so anyone, and now Jim is laughing. And so it just feels so good. It just, boy, it's like a party in the brain in terms of neurotransmitters. Okay, so then other things, feeling awe. Awe is a transformative emotion. We don't have that many joy and awe. So awe is experiencing the beauty of nature or of human kindness or of animal, anything. It's just that feeling of awe is actually one of the magical ingredients in life. So we're going to give you an exercise so you can actually consciously decide to feel awe in that moment. Other things, we talked about, you know, the focus on negative is just all around us, but positive things happen all the time and positive qualities are in all of us. And so capitalizing on that means talking about it and sharing it and reliving it. And that's very powerful. So another thing to do when we're done with this call is to share something that happened to you recently that made you happy with someone else. Because guess what? That is a powerful dose of joy that you're letting them experience as well. And then when you relive it, you feel it too. So that's what I feel when I hear, you know, Desmond Tutu and His Holiness have this conversation. I'm having so much kind of vicarious joy from their capitalizing and savoring. Reframing is a big theme we've been talking about. We all have adversity. We have global shared adversity. And when we can refocus on the positive that's there, it's truly silver. It's actually solid gold. The silver lining must be seen. And so we have an exercise to help you shift and see the silver lining.
Wow. I am so excited about this project because, you know, the holy men didn't tell us just get the film to everyone. They said, get the idea, get our ideas to everyone. And the very fact that we barely heard about how we could do this and how people could go online and do this for a week and at the end of the week actually get their prescription for joy. Like, we know that this works for you. You could do more of this if this works for you. And you can also see how many people around the world are with you doing this at the moment. This all was lives in Alyssa's brain, I just have to say. And this
Emiliana, devoting so much of her life to making this happen, and other teams at Berkeley through the Greater Good Science Center. So this is a huge team effort with people who, you know, this is our dream to try to deliver this globally, this beautiful science of the mind.
And how, if do people know how to sign up or how to?
Yeah, that's what we're going. So right now, and at the end of the end of our program, there's a QR code. You can go there, and it will allow you to sign up for this, and it is being made as we speak by Berkeley, and at their Greater Goods Center. And it is just going to be so much fun. It will take you less than 5 minutes a day. You will not only be helping yourself, you'll be helping the planet, because it turns out that scientists do know the micro actions you can take to feel better. What they're not so great at is figuring out what actions work for which people, how culture impacts it, how age impacts it, how sex impacts it. And so you will not only be positively affecting your own life, you will be advancing science around the world. And I'm not so sure it gets really any better than that. That's just too cool.
Peggy, if you can't follow a QR code, is there a URL people can go to find out?
Sure. Thank you for that, Doug. It's missionjoy.org. You go there, big as life, you can see where you can sign up for it. And here's a little secret. If you go do it, you know that laugh, the holy men's laugh? People keep telling us they wish that we would just bottle that laughter and spread it around. Well, we did. We actually did that. So when you sign up, you will get a little gift that keeps on giving. You will get to hear their laughter in your inbox that you can take advantage of anytime you would like.
Empathic joy. Didn't you say, isn't that what you call it? You get to have that, or empathic laughter. So
joy on the go, you know?
Yeah, joy to go. Oh my gosh, it's joy to go. I love that. But I have to tell you, I have to warn you. I really, 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 you know, because I'm a giver and I care. I really want you to only do this if you want to have a little fun and feel a little better, because you hear that laughter and it's over, you're done. Yeah. You guys, we only have a few more minutes. I am wondering if there's any other things, any little nuggets that you wish that you had shared, because we're gonna have to say goodbye in a few minutes, and I'd really like you to say whatever is meaningful to you.
No, one thing I wanted to say is that this movie came out in a perfect time, because right now, all over the world, everybody's struggling. And that question about hopelessness is real for many of us. part of the challenge is we don't seem to be able to see when and how it's going to end, this current pandemic. So in this current situation, this film is very timely. And also joining communities like today's screening is an important part of taking an active step to really kind of, you know, and instead of waiting for things to happen to us, you know, we need to, you know, assert our agency, take active step. So I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of you who are really kind of actively trying to make these accessible to so many. And to you, Peggy, especially for actually making the movie. Thank you.
Melissa, Doug?
I'll let Doug have the last word. And I'll just say, as a health researcher, our research and others show that living with adversity, and I'll just use my caregivers, you know, I study parents like me of children with chronic conditions, and they get worn out biologically, but not if they have a good dose of eudaimonia, of being able to see the good in people and in life and being able to feel positive, not all the time, of course, because we're talking about, we're all living in this shared context of suffering. And so joy, being able to tap into it and purposefully deciding to is, you know, it's magic, it's medicine. And so I agree with Jinpa that bringing this out and highlighting this at this time, Peggy, is such a gift to the world. It's so needed. And I hope everyone listening will, rather than feeling like I don't have enough joy, just realizing that it's these little moments that you really can have, they're accessible to you.
And I think I would just add to the beautiful things that Jinpa and Alyssa have just said, that so much of that is focusing on our ability to share joy with others. That was kind of one of the bottom line takeaways, is the more joy we share, the more joy we have. And so whether that's, and these are just here as resources, you know, screening the film on your campuses to share the joy in that way, figuring out kind of based on what you've heard today, what you can take and share with others increases your joy as well, and obviously creates that culture of joy and resilience and hope that we were talking about earlier on for our young people, for our campuses and our communities and our organizations. And I just want to end by just saying that, Peggy, you have experienced a great adversity in the last week by having your face get paralyzed, and yeah, or half your face get paralyzed. And you didn't let that stop you. You didn't, you know, I mean, I'm super vain. I might have said, I can't do this. You just said, heck, I'm going to do this because it's going to bring joy to other people. And you went beyond your own adversity, your own suffering. And you're an incredible example of exactly what we're talking about, of when we go beyond our own self-regard, beyond our own pain, and can turn, as Art says, to wiping the tears of another, or helping to spread that joy with that laughter. It is contagious, and it is the positive contagion we need now to be fighting our pandemic of both our physical illness and our mental health pandemic. And I just want to thank you for this. I want to thank Jinpa and Alyssa. I want to thank our organizers from ROCO and from ProQuest, and all of you who are listening. It's such a gift to be with you all today.
Thank you, Doug. Thank you for outing my frozen face. I thought I wanted to come on today and do, oh, thanks for us all being here to talk about Frozen. So thank you all. Thank you, Alyssa, Doug, and Jinpa, for sharing your wisdom, your joy, your laughter. And thank you for all of you out there today who tuned in to be a part of this. We received so many wonderful questions, and I'm sorry that we couldn't get to them all. I also want to thank ROCO Films, the film platform, and ProQuest for bringing this all together. And if you haven't seen the film yet, you can still see it at ProQuest via your school library, so check it out. And be looking at in your inbox for some more resources you're going to get that that goes along with this program. And guess what? It's Arch's 90th birthday in 2 days. and you will have the ability to actually write him a birthday message, and we will get it to him. And if you also would like to go ahead and write a message to Arch, you can do that on our website, I mean, to His Holiness. We send them to him, and that's at missionjoy.org. And you can sign up for a screening there. You can do so many things. So get ready for that. Get ready for the holy men's laughter. And here is a quick preview of some more great documentary films that you can see on the film platform and ProQuest. And also, if you wouldn't mind, we would really like you to answer some of the survey questions that are going to come to you. It just helps us get better at what we do. And if we're better at what we do, you're going to like it better too. Thanks. Thank you for joining us with joy.
Thank you, everyone.
That's not American. I don't know what is.
We have a goal that's never been done before. We want to take the first picture of a black hole.
We don't appreciate your work.
Okay, we're ready.
My job is to make sure the horror of what's going on stays front and center.
You are a monk, remember?
Our job is to change the world in the United States of America.
It's the biggest heist in modern American political history.
Was it hard becoming a Supreme Court justice because you were a woman?
We're gonna win big. You just watch.
Where are we? And they told me Auschwitz.
Heartbreaking day in Florida, and sadly an all too familiar one.
Anybody that thinks the NRA is going to disappear has got another thing coming.